High Bridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Jersey Breaks, Becoming an American Poet, by Robert Pinsky, read by Robert Pinsky. The book is dedicated to Jill Neerham. Gimme a break, folk saying. Sorrow would break the seal stamped over time and set the baskets where the bough is bent. Louise Bogan, Simple Autumnal. But love has pitched his mansion in the place of excrement, for nothing can be soul or whole that has not been rent. William Butler Yeats, Crazy Jane Talks with the Bishop. Prologue. Given my background, a friend asked me, how is it I became a poet rather than a criminal or an optometrist? I could quibble. My father, Milford Pinsky, was an optician, not an optometrist, a common mistake. And it's true that his father, Dave Pinsky, was a criminal. But as my Aunt Thelma used to say, her pop was in the liquor business, and it happened to be during Prohibition. That was the era when Dave, my Zadie pop, as I called him, pursued the liquor business in our hometown, Long Branch, New Jersey. Trivial and significant, stupid and profound, like a family oppressive and nurturing, like the larger world seductive and treacherous. My feelings about the town are as confused as can be. My bedeviled patriotism, my need for the lofty outcast art of poetry, my C student's distrust of worldly rewards and punishments, the inward voice that spurs me to bring together disparate times, places, and things, that attraction to a mishmash, all began in Long Branch. If I have a story to tell, it's how the failures and aspirations of a certain time and place led to poetry. Chapter 1. A Provincial Sense of Time. At a Library of Congress luncheon in Washington in the year 2000, the speakers included Congressman Frank Pallone of Long Branch, New Jersey. Frank Pallone's family and mine had known one another for three generations. His father, Frank Pallone Sr., was a respected cop of the old-school kind who might catch a 13-year-old shoplifting and lock the kid into a cell for a few hours, then let him go with a lecture. The congressman's mother was a figure in Long Branch town legend. She went to the beach looking great in her leopard-spotted two-piece bathing suit with her two little boys, Frank and his brother, togged out in their matching leopard-spotted trunks. Frank Pallone has said that to understand my poetry, you need to understand our town. I know what he means. The races and ethnicities, with all the other blends, resistances, suspicions, borrowings, intermarriages, rivalries, and molten allies of American cuisine, art, and social life, all concentrated in a seashore resort that was near great cities, yet, by definition, away from them. That was a world the congressman and I had known all our lives. Also at the head table that day was another person I admired. The elegant Lynn Chase had just arrived on a flight from New York to attend this Washington event in her capacity as president of the Academy of American Poets. A beautiful woman in her 70s, Lynn was a sharp-witted patron of the arts, charming and very rich and accustomed to getting her way. Quote, I got off the plane and realized I had no credit cards or money, Lynn said when I greeted her. So I had to pick up a man who would give me a ride to get here. After Representative Pallone finished his remarks at the microphone, Lynn Chase asked me, Is the congressman coming back? No, he headed back to the Hill. Good, I was surprised to hear her say. I hate his brother. I thought of the two little boys in their leopard swimsuits. And also, I thought of the recent mayoral campaign in Long Branch. Adam Schneider had been reelected mayor, but Frank Pallone's younger brother, John Pallone, unexpectedly challenged Adam, running a failed campaign against him. The election campaign had gotten a bit rough, as I heard from my aunts and cousins, straining a long friendship between the two families, the Schneiders and the Pallones. There were lots of people in town with those names. Exactly the kind of thing the congressman remarked on in my poems. Over dessert and coffee, I tried to explain this Long Branch story at some length. Maybe I even mentioned Marion Pallone's leopard-spotted bathing suit. Meanwhile, the Library of Congress officials at our table and Lynn Chase all listened politely. As I finished talking a little too much, I said how surprised I was that Lynn knew about the congressman's family. How had she come to hate his brother? Lynn responded mildly. What I said was, I ate his butter. I sometimes think with my ears and my voice, putting music above meaning. It's a habit that has been my failing and my calling. Little Silver, Hazlitt, Perth Amboy, Rahway, and Secaucus were stops on the New York and Long Branch Railroad. I don't know much about those places, but the consonants and vowels of their names, chanted by old-school conductors on the way to Penn Station, made a familiar, seductive music. My many aunts and uncles lived in Hoboken, Hackensack, Summit, Passaic, Hopewell, and the Oranges. Which family lived where, I don't remember, but those place names made a verbal harmony, like what I found years later in 16th-century lyrics, poetry by John Dowland and Thomas Campion. My mishearing Lynn's words, I ate his butter, is an example of the provincial sense of time. In a proper understanding of time, you focus on causes and effects over centuries or years or hours. But from a limited, intensely local viewpoint, the centuries and years and hours might be understood through a particular place and its people. That's how I misheard Lynn Chase's plain sentence. Space, in the form of a town and its imagination, preempted the reality of time. In a certain kind of place, everything can feel simultaneous. Somewhere in my imagination, along with a rational sense of history, general and personal, I dwell in a cloudy olden days, where the two little boys with their pretty mother, all three of them in leopard-spotted swimsuits, walked to the beach down a stairway from the bluff being painted by Winslow Homer, crossing the boardwalk in Ocean Avenue where they could buy lunch at Max's famous hot dogs and admire the fast horses of President Grant, who defeated the forces of evil in the Civil War. Grant, a friend of Mark Twain, and a hard-drinking man who might buy his prohibited whiskey from my Zadie Pop, or maybe drink it at Zadie Pop's Broadway Tavern near the Garfield Grant Hotel. Landmarks in an irrational but significant past that may even include the Dawson's Landing of Mark Twain, along with the Dublin of James Joyce, all the terrain, as Congressman Frank Pallone recognized, of my imagination. The blending of different periods in time weaves into the haphazard blending of cultures in a way the congressman understood. I inherited an edgy mix of hierarchies and goofs, tribal alliances and conflicts, ways of surviving and ways of storytelling, local and global. I grew up inculcated with awe of the past, an awe that went beyond any actual reliable knowledge of the past. A personal landmark for me was one of the main junkyards in Long Branch that used to belong to a man named, as if by Charles Dickens, Ash. I went to Izzy Ash's junkyard in the summer of 1962 to buy a used fuel pump for a 1953 Dodge Coronet convertible I wanted to drive to Palo Alto, California. I was going to graduate school at Stanford. Mr. Ash took in that information as he grunted and tugged at a long-handled wrench to loosen the part I needed from a wrecked coronet. I told Mr. Ash that I was going to graduate school, not that I was going to be a writer or a poet. As it happens, he knew more than you might expect about going to graduate school, and I had already been embarrassed earlier that summer by local people knowing that I was, or that I meant to become, a writer. A Long Branch boy named Danny Pingator was having a little success under another name as a television actor. The absurdity of the ambition that I was carrying west with me seemed clear when Danny phoned me. I didn't really know him. He was at least 5 years older than me, but I knew his brother Anthony. Their mother had run into mine in a store when Danny was in Long Branch for part of July, so he had my phone number. "Robert, this is Danny Pingator. Your mother says you're going out to California to be a writer, and there's something I really need to tell you, Robert. Don't go." "What?" "Don't go, Robert. I mean it. I know a lot of writers in L.A. They all say this is the worst year ever. Nobody is doing hour-long shows anymore. It's all half-hour. Most of the writers already out there can't find work." So I just told Mr. Ash I was going to Stanford to graduate school. In Izzy Ash's class at Long Branch High School, there were two outstanding students, both from Jewish families. Both went to Harvard. Mike Abrams and Barry Green were two brilliant and ambitious Long Branch boys whose stories still meant something to Mr. Ash as he braced his feet against the sandy, shadeless, oil-stained dirt of his junkyard, and he pulled free the fuel pump for my coronet. He had his generation's respect for what performing well in school could do for somebody whose family had no money or power. So Mr. Ash told me about Mike and Barry. Mike Abrams went from Harvard College to graduate school, and he became a distinguished professor, the author of a famous book, The Mirror and the Lamp, a study of two romantic images for poetry. Although I had not exactly read the book, I had it on good authority that it was, as it did turn out to be, very good. The other Harvard boy in that same high school class, Barry Green, went on to become a rich lawyer, but sadly, as Mr. Ash told me the story he knew I knew, things took a bad turn for Barry Green. In the course of his climb to success, Barry got in deep with the mob, including a deal that involved selling orange peels to the government for the production of synthetic sugar. Like those leopard-spotted bathing suits of the Pallone boys and their beautiful mom, the orange peels were a familiar, legendary detail. The words synthetic sugar added the authority of specificity to our local tale of a deal saturated in fraud, bribery, chicanery, even, when you think about it, despoiling the United States Treasury in wartime. The dukes and generals of the mob, protecting the myth of their patriotism, declared that Barry Green would have to go to prison, and so he did. The unthinkable alternative was agreeing to testify with the likelihood of sudden disappearance. Barry's wife and his two daughters, attractive girls who took elocution lessons, the younger one the first girl in town to play Little League baseball, they were taken care of by those dukes and generals. Meanwhile, the story concluded, Mike Abrams continued the beautiful life of an honored professor at Cornell University, an Ivy League college in a class with Harvard itself, as Mr. Ash said, sighing emphatically. Mr. Ash knew from his daughter Phyllis, my classmate, that I had not been a good student in high school. Retelling the legend of Mike and Barry was his way of indicating respect for my apparent new seriousness. Wiping his head with his forearm, he finished with a moral, expressed by an example from our shared provincial landscape. Yes, Robert, there's two different paths in life. It's just like North Broadway and South Broadway. Broadway's two forks, North and South, form a Y just a couple of blocks from Long Branch's beachfront boardwalk. I nodded solemnly at Mr. Ashe's moral, his allegory of those two streets as two paths in life. At the same time, I was thinking that the two paths were pretty much identical. Mr. Ashe and I both knew quite well that North Broadway and South Broadway, not notably different from one another, extend to arrive, one long block apart, at exactly the same place, the Atlantic Ocean. Maybe the point of his story was the reality of shared knowledge, that he and I and the other people in our community all knew the same streets and the same stories. Maybe Mr. Ashe was thinking about my probably outliving him and about my passage into a future as large and as mysterious as the ocean itself. California, books, poetry. He wanted to speak as the voice of the past, addressing the future. Chapter 2, Rockwell. In 1947, when I was 7 years old and my sister was two, my father got fired from the only job he had had since he was in high school. He and my mother were already painfully aware that many of their friends had bought suburban houses in Elberon or Oakhurst, while we were still crowding the four of us into a two-bedroom apartment at 36 Rockwell Avenue, near the corner of Monmouth Avenue. The people who lived on Monmouth Avenue, nearly all of them, were black. One exception was the apartment of my friends Jerry and Irwin Faber, halfway down Monmouth, next door to their father's junkyard. I Faber scrap metal. Irwin was a year younger than me, Jerry a year older. A couple of my exact contemporaries at school, Billy Hanford and Lloyd Weaver, lived near the Fabers. I think one of them next door. Rockwell was all white people, mostly Italian and Jewish. The racial border, with its unspoken rules, seemed so unquestioned that I don't think white flight was much of an issue, or not yet. It was a poor neighborhood and a segregated one, or you could call it two adjoining poor neighborhoods. In the summer, during the racing season, when the horses were running at Monmouth Park, some trainers and exercise boys rented rooms on Rockwell, so for a few weeks it felt more prosperous. The houses on Monmouth Avenue and Rockwell Avenue were converted multifamilies, originally built as one-family places. I can identify the style now as the craftsman period of the 1920s. When I read about the craftsman style decades later, I remembered how in our apartment the plaster walls were not smooth, but crinkly, in an artistic random pattern. The irregular-shaped slates of the front walk were in that style of the same period. The paving was called crazy paving. Our walls and our front walk were inspired at many removes by the political and social writings of John Ruskin and William Morris. Their progressive ideas about art in the lives of ordinary people in the new industrial age of machine-made artifacts. On the corner of Rockwell and Monmouth, across the street from where we lived, was the office of Julius McKelvey, M.D., the neighborhood's black doctor. About the same time as I learned about craftsman houses and William Morris, I discovered that Dr. McKelvey, from his borderland house and office at the corner of Rockwell and Monmouth, was active in the early years of the NAACP. Dr. McKelvey worked patiently, for years fruitlessly, to integrate the Long Branch beaches. Only one beach allowed black people access to the segregated Atlantic Ocean. I remember glimpses from across the street of Dr. McKelvey in his three-piece suit. At the other end of Monmouth Avenue, at the corner of Liberty Street, was the Tally Ho Tavern, where once, in a legendary bar fight, somebody bit off a policeman's finger. Next door to the Tally Ho on Liberty Street, a couple of my white friends, Andy Cullen and Martin Gates, lived with their mothers, who may have been sisters. Andy was blonde and sweet-natured. Martin was dark-haired, also a good friend, but not as open. Andy's father, he confided, was a soldier who died in an explosion when he was guarding an ammunition storehouse. Martin's stepfather was a Comanche Indian, a gloomy man I glimpsed once or twice where he was brooding in a shadowy bedroom. He once had studied to be a dentist, Martin told me. When I visited Long Branch High School, as a smiling 60-year-old public man, the words I could say that most impressed the assembled students were Rockwell Avenue, a rough hood to them, a slum, as my mother called it, in arguments that intensified after my father lost his job. Together, partly as a way to deny what seemed his failure in those years, Milford and Sylvia Pinsky took pride in their wit, their skill as dancers and at games, their good looks and their style. Politicians talk about family values. The Pinsky family valued our belief that we were better looking than other people, also funnier, and, with scant justification, that we had better taste, especially in clothes. Henry David Thoreau's dictum, "Beware of all enterprises that require new clothes," always makes me think, that's not how I was brought up. Wardrobe ranked above rehearsal. Sylvia dressed me, her firstborn, carefully. "I washed his white shoelaces," she used to say. Clothes, in a way, compensated for real estate. Ads for the ranch-style tract houses in Elbron, houses that we could not afford, celebrated their picture windows in the living room, wide, factory-sealed panes of glass, uninterrupted by movable sash. My mother mocked the pictures you could see from the picture windows of those identical houses. Mainly, the view was the house across the street. Some picture, some ranch. "Or maybe," she said, "it's all about the picture you can look at when you drive by. Ruthie Edelstein's ass, wide like the window." After my brother was born, there were three of us kids in the two-bedroom Rockwell Avenue apartment. Sylvia and Milford began searching more desperately for a post-war tract house that might be in their price range. Around that time, at the age of 10 or 11, I began to understand that our family's preening scorn was defensive. Also, in another sense, offensive. The outlaw swagger of my grandfather, Dave Pinsky, the barkeeper and former bootlegger, may have inspired that spurious glamour. I don't know how much my parents' pose of superiority to suburban homeowners was related in my mind later, as a newly literary college kid, to the superiority of James Joyce, Virginia Woolf, and Marcel Proust to Pearl Buck and her Nobel Prize, or to Herman Wouk and the movies based on his bestsellers. I was overeager to embrace kinds of judgment I had not done the work to earn. It would be many years before I could absorb the truth, harsh but liberating, that judgment in art depends on work, not hearsay. And it is never final. Willa Cather, in The Song of the Lark, tells the great truth about the serious artist who dies never being sure of their art's measure. When Cather celebrates the shards of clay vessels that once carried water, for the makers who shaped them, fired them, and painted them. She conveys how the work itself is the reward and the punishment. My freshman year posing did not mean I was stupid or entirely a phony. I was callow, but I did know how to read with attention. I could recognize the Dublin of Joyce's Ulysses, with its bar talkers and local histories, the provincial web of backbiting, loyalty, and gossip. It was like Long Branch, and yet all of that soiled vitality Joyce created was also his reenactment of the Odyssey. The good singing voice and sharp tongue of Stephen Dedalus's father, Simon Dedalus, and the magnetism of sexy Molly Bloom. Performative local figures Dublin at large admired, yet frowned at. They stirred recognition in me. Characters respected for their gifts, but not entirely respectable, were a type I recognized. Even the wandering, inventive hero of the Odyssey was a bit of a bullshit artist. In a way, it was music that brought me to Ulysses. In my freshman year at Rutgers, the first-year course, Introduction to Literature, was required for two kinds of student, prospective majors in English and in physical education. Sections of the course were reserved for one category or the other. Because band rehearsals affected my schedule, I was assigned to a section where everybody else was planning to major in physical education. Their commitments to athletic practices and games corresponded to my rehearsal and practice times. I was in the jazz band, but more practically in the marching band, which released me from carrying a rifle in the reserve officers training corps. ROTC was required back then for the first 2 years at all American state universities. We were cannon fodder, or at least drill fodder, with our presence giving the real 4-year ROTC students lots of people in uniforms to receive their orders. While other freshmen carried rifles and learned the manual of arms, I carried my Butcher Aristocrat tenor saxophone. And while the others in my intro to lit class played sports, I played my part in the lower ranks of the reed section for big band arrangements of the Bartlesville Boogie or In the Mood. I don't mean to stereotype the athletes. Some of them were impressive writers and readers, but in that class, I shone, and I knew it. Worse, I was pretentious enough and naive enough to show that I knew it. The teacher, Maurice Charney, gave me extra assignments such as, for example, writing a parody of T.S. Eliot's The Wasteland in the style of Raymond Chandler. To take me gently down a notch, and maybe to amuse himself, Charney one day asked me, with a straight face, had I ever read Ulysses by James Joyce? I don't think so, sir. I had never heard of the author or the book, but I got a copy from the library. A lot of it confused me. On the first page, one character emerges from something called the stairhead to join others on a tower where somebody leans on a gun rest. Maybe they were soldiers at war? Somebody who talks a lot in those first pages is wearing something called a dressing gown while holding a shaving bowl. Those mysterious objects, like Joyce's cloud of literary references, bewildered me in an exciting way. But I loved Ulysses as a book about New Jersey. Years later, I recognized that feeling when I read an interview with Gabriel Garcia Marquez, where he says that the best South American novel ever written is The Hamlet by William Faulkner. As an ambitious, pseudo-intellectual freshman, I set out to understand what Joyce's autobiographical character, Stephen Dedalus, means by saying that history is a nightmare from which I am trying to awake. Those words of Joyce's priggish, arrogant young alter ego, became a guide for me. In the personal canon that I began to improvise, Elizabeth Bishop, Isaac Bobble, William Shakespeare, Ralph Ellison, Emily Dickinson, Franz Kafka, Alan Dugan, Sophocles, and Mark Harris dealt with history as a nightmare and the struggle to wake up from it. With something like religious ardor, I started trying to understand how the young Irish character's declaration about trying to awake might apply to my experience of the United States of America. Working at it, I stumbled into a sort of patriotic American response to Joyce's two-pronged, haughty, and blasphemous way of retelling the greatest adventure in Western art. The Odyssey gets retold as one day when a lower-class Jew and an ambitious, nightmare-driven young writer bustle and wander around the streets of Dublin. In my heart of a newly minted highbrow, I adored the story of Stephen Dedalus and Leopold Bloom and their shared journey in history and, maybe, out of history. I recognized the journey the way I recognized Dublin. Closer to home, I read the poetry of William Carlos Williams, brimming with the mixed and mixed-up immigrant cultures of Williams's New Jersey and mine. I understood why Williams made his tangled family history defy understanding in a tribute to his grandmother, dedication for a plot of ground. I knew at once how the incomprehensibility, the tangled nature of the story, is the point. This plot of ground, facing the waters of this inlet, is dedicated to the living presence of Emily Dickinson Wellcome, who was born in England, married, lost her husband, and with her 5-year-old son sailed for New York in a 2-master, was driven to the Azores, ran adrift on Fire Island Shoal, met her second husband in a Brooklyn boarding house, went with him to Puerto Rico, bore 3 more children, lost her second husband, lived hard for 8 years in St. Thomas, Puerto Rico, San Domingo, followed the eldest son to New York, lost her daughter, lost her baby, seized the 2 boys of the oldest son by the second marriage, mothered them, they being motherless, fought for them against the other grandmother and the aunts. This poem's disorderly narrative of disorder, with its broken families, forced emigrations, place names, and contentious relatives, the poem was exactly the kind of jumbled story I had heard in the conversation of my aunts and uncles, and even more of a mishmash, the stories of my great-aunts and great-uncles. In a different way from the Irish exiled Joyce, the New Jersey poet Williams, with his Spanish middle name and his English grandmother, made me feel what I still believe is the central issue of American life, the quest for a democratic culture. Were those 2 words a contradiction in terms? And if not, what might they mean? Not that I can answer, but overriding every mere election and underlying every national abomination or achievement, I feel the tremendous compacted force, call it nuclear, of that enigmatic, idealized duality, a democratic culture. Clearly, such a culture would have to be blended, as Williams intuited. Early on, as a young writer tinkering with his own name, he signed his first book, William C. Williams. After that, he seriously considered using W.C. Williams. Then finally, he decided on who he became, defined by the almost comically ordinary and similar first name and last name on either side, escorting between them the central Carlos. The name, William Carlos Williams, is the more American because it is hybrid, implying an immigrant story, the aspiration for a new, mixed democratic culture. The history of what I mean is as multiple as the precise, yet murky, genealogical chains of the Hebrew Bible, that terse geometry of cause and effect, parent and offspring. The minimal, abrupt quality of this one begat that one fascinated me as a child. In Hebrew characters on the right-hand page of the prayer book, with the English on the left. In Hebrew school, our teacher, Mr. Gewurz, divided us 11 and 12-year-old students into two teams for the reading aloud game called baseball. Saying two lines of Hebrew from the prayer book with no mistakes got you to first base. Mistakes were outs, and stumbles or hesitations were strikes. We knew the meanings of only a few words, so in that competition of phonetic performance, it was all the equivalent of names. Mahalalel and Methuselah and Japheth. Babbling for perfection was fun. In another way, so was admiring Mr. Gewurz's mental acrobatics as he defended the idea that in the Torah there were absolutely no contradictions and no mere repetitions. The begats of weird names, living there hundreds of years, were scary and funny at once. The stories of all that death and endeavor, coupling and fracture, resemble the jumbled information Williams assembles in his dedication for a plot of ground. In Genesis, an immense turbulent flow of lives and deaths has been cooked down to minimal pairs of barely pronounceable names. Salah begat Eber, and then he lived 403 years, and then he died. The begats mocked and lamented the darkness of actual, real lives folded away into the shadows of their syllables for centuries. Those genealogical catalogs gesture at the mostly lethal history behind them and after them. Some people get killed by Cossacks or Nazis, while their cousins sell eyeglasses or illegal whiskey. The genealogy of causes and effects, along with the curses of recurring genocide, slavery, and expropriation, enumerates a history not just of survival, as they taught us in Hebrew school, but of inseparable confusion, beauty, and horror. On Rockwell Avenue, history was a hidden force behind nearly everything, black and white, Christian and Jew, colors and levels and flavors right in front of me, but with unseen causes, authors, and consequences. Andy Cullen and Martin Gates lived at the Liberty end of Monmouth Avenue. Dr. McKelvey at the Rockwell end. I had a father, and Andy Cullen did not. Andy's hair was yellow and straight. His cousin Martin's was dark and straight like mine, and Lloyd Weaver's was black in tight curls. Our Rockwell landlord, Mr. Cutter, slept the night in a tool shed when he came around to collect our rent or to putter in the yard. He was someone to be avoided because he was a drunkard and he did not like Jews. Because Cutter's nose was red with hairy yellow pores, I still do not like strawberries. One day I was sitting on our front steps watching Mr. Cutter digging in the front yard when our elderly neighbor, Mrs. Henry, walked by. I was about 5 years old. "You ought to get him to help you," she said, smiling toward me. She meant me, the little boy. But Mr. Cutter looked at the house and thought she meant my father. "No," he said, "you can't get no work out of a Jew." All of this information had its history, much of it a nightmare, and nearly all of it invisible, though I could feel its presence. It was as though Andy and Lloyd and I each knew different secrets, kept in the dark, even though we played together most days. Mr. Cutter knew some other secret. Even my parents' arguments about where we lived had their separate histories or secrets. His father's mob ties, her father's feckless repeated moves around the country. A terrifying clot of secrets in the words, Jesus Christ. People said those words mostly in anger or shock. Coming from Mr. Cutter, they would be pure menace. But in the songs called carols, and the other songs called spirituals, those words enclosed an elevated sweetness forbidden to us Jews, or hidden from us. Mr. Cutter inherited the Rockwell house from his mother, whose corpse, my mother said, he might have hidden in the immense padlocked travel trunk stored on a ledge above our basement stairway. That seemed unlikely but possible. Trying to understand the web of interwoven delusions, stories, and realities was an effort that sometimes led to mistaken ideas. In my family, we were Jews, and we were all right-handed. The black kids I knew from Monmouth Avenue also all happened to write and throw as righties. But at school, I noticed that a white Gentile kid named Jerry Fornin wrote with his left hand. Andy Cullen, too, was a lefty. So for a little while, I thought only certain goyim could be left-handed. My mother's fantasy about Mr. Cutter's dead mother, like Dr. McKelvey being prevented from swimming at Kramer's Beach, or strawberry-nosed Cutter hating Jews, all of that went deeper than handwriting or swimming. Deeper in a way than even hating or dying. Everything came from a nameless, densely crazy power that ruled the world. Even poetry, even music, even sex, all were on that power's dark agenda. Chapter 3, Little Egypt. The Tally Ho Tavern once advertised an exotic dancer named Little Egypt. The poster with her picture impressed me. At the age of 11, I understood that the word Egypt involved the remote past. I didn't know that for 100 years, dozens of American dancers of different races, mostly strippers or belly dancers, had been billed as Little Egypt. By the time I was 12, we had moved away from Rockwell and the Tally Ho Tavern to Woolley Avenue, near the high school. The two words, Little Egypt, made a thrilling combination of the familiar and the unknown. Sex was only part of it. Years later, the Coasters had a hit song called Little Egypt, covered by Elvis Presley. By that time, I was at Rutgers, trying to be a poet and to think about an American version of waking up from the nightmare of history. But the nightmare was also alluring. Whoever invented the name Little Egypt in the 19th century understood its appeal, entangled in the history of girly shows and the nude, colonialism and exoticism, the male gaze and fetishes. She did the hoochie-coochie real slow, sang the Coasters, with the Lieber and Stoller lyrics using another 19th century phrase, hoochie-coochie. As with actual dreams, the horrible and the desired corruption and culture were not rationally segregated. Stephen Dedalus's awakening might be too simple a term. In another way, but also skeptical, I absorbed an idea from a history class that although we are a great nation, we in the United States had not yet become a great people. Still an ongoing effort, with the racial divide only the largest, clearest fracture. Could our public education and our popular culture hold us together in that effort? That would depend upon our works of art, I decided. Still that much of a Stephen Dedalus loyalist. As a college freshman newly converted to literature with a capital L, I became a devotee of Shelley's College Bookstore on Somerset Street in New Brunswick. That store advertised thousands of books from 19 cents to $1.98. For a clean, used copy of the Laurel paperback edition of Emily Dickinson's poems, Introduction by Richard Wilbur, I paid something near the bottom of that price range. Shelley's also sold new books, and I splurged $2.50 on the City Lights edition of Cottage and Other Poems by Allen Ginsberg. Most profound and extravagant of all, I paid Mr. Shelley an almost unthinkable sum, $5 or $6, I think, for a new hardcover collected poems of William Butler Yeats in the definitive edition of 1956. I was ignorant of the actual realities of the book business. I had no idea that books were like movies or music, with the important products being the new releases of each season. That naivete persisted into my 30s when I finally learned about the terms backlist, remaindered, and out of print. The presence of a title on Shelley's used shelves was evidence for me that it might be a significant book. The older and more battered the copy, the more impressive the author might be. Unlike some of my friends, I was not mainly interested in what was new. It was freedom of access to the classics that thrilled me. Orlando Patterson writes about the word freedom in relation to the Virginia planters who practiced slavery and profited from it, and who wrote our founding documents. Did they value the word precisely because freedom was a daily visible denominator for the difference between themselves and the kidnapped African people they had enslaved and sometimes raped? Patterson has said that in seeking to understand the evil wolf, slavery, he found this unlikely lamb, freedom. The Virginians created, in their own interests and to fill their needs, an intense reimagining that lifted up the very word freedom. And the enslaved people, trying to awaken from the nightmare, adapted freedom and deployed it, as they did Christianity. Adaptation as distinct from waking up, or as a form of waking up. That idea helps me think about real-life quirks and paradoxes. For instance, Monmouth Avenue, with Little Egypt and Dr. Julius McKelvey at opposite ends of that short street. I can't pretend to analyze its history beyond a misty, almost parodic sense of begats. The English class system begat dissenting Protestant settlers, who begat profit and enterprise, and profit and enterprise begat settlers, and settlers begat colonialism, genocide, and slavery. Slavery begat field chants and lynching, and field chants begat the blues, and the blues begat Duke Ellington, and Duke Ellington begat Ella Fitzgerald and John Coltrane and Stan Getz playing Brazilian rhythms with Astru Gilberto, and the Borscht Belt begat Margaret Cho and Chris Rock. Lynching begat the Southern strategy of the Republicans. European emigration begat nostalgic yearning, and nostalgic yearning begat opera houses, and opera houses begat vaudeville, and vaudeville begat four-year-old Buster Keaton's father throwing his athletic little child around the stage, and East Coast entrepreneurs begat Hollywood, and Hollywood begat Bollywood long after it begat the grown-up Buster Keaton. And the grown-up Buster Keaton begat Jackie Chan years after he begat Sid Caesar and Imogene Coca. Sid Caesar and Imogene Coca begat Carol Burnett and Harvey Korman. In my own microcosm of poetry, T.S. Eliot begat Allen Ginsberg, who wrote imitations of T.S. Eliot and had erotic dreams about him. When I first discovered Eliot and Ginsberg, in the beatnik ambience of college, I read their poetry eagerly and thought the two poets were quite similar. Later, in class, I was taught that they were utterly different. A decade or so later, I realized that they were quite similar. Another source of confidence. When I was very young, in our Rockwell Avenue days, my family watched on television Sid Caesar's great parodies of operas and foreign movies, and we laughed at them together. Also, we were not only proud of Count Basie as a native of Monmouth County, we had his records. That is one piece of evidence for the Pinsky claim that we had good taste. We listened to Basie and Ellington, and we watched Sid Caesar. We scorned Lawrence Welk, who triumphed over Caesar, broadcasting in the same competitive time slot. I had never seen an opera, nor a foreign movie, but I loved the parodies and learned from them something essential about how the world lives in art. From Caesar's double talk in Italian, French, Japanese, languages whose melodies he could improvise all the more effectively, more purely, because he did not know the languages in the ordinary sense of knowing, I learned something essential about language itself. Who could claim, when Ellington and Keaton were new, who could claim to know that their art was great? Who could predict that Sherlock Jr. and black and tan fantasy would come to be curated by American universities? Also, Burt Williams and Groucho Marx, along with William Carlos Williams. Who knows nowadays which hip-hop performers, or which contemporary writers for television, or which contemporary poets will be so honored by the generation currently about to enter kindergarten? Who cares? In fact, I do. I care, even though I can't pretend to know. And there are experts who do know, or will. Or is it too sunny, too optimistic on my part to concentrate on the historic work of Ellington and Keaton and the scholarly caretakers of their art? Is it a sad, terrible doom that their work now rests, as in mausoleums, in universities? Or, after all, is it a hopeful indication that American culture is democratic and scholarly, both? That it embraces Ellington's music and Keaton's films, available to the generations, as Joyce and Dickinson were available to me when I was 17? Or is it more important to realize how much bad has always come along with the good? The culture, along with producing Emily Dickinson and Sid Caesar and T.S. Eliot and Allen Ginsberg and George Gershwin and Willa Cather and Preston Sturgis and Elizabeth Bishop and John Coltrane and Nina Simone and Richard Pryor and Gwendolyn Brooks and Mel Brooks and Robert Hayden and Stanley Kubrick, also produced a stupendous, toxic flood of vulgarity. Is it more to the point that the Great Depression begat radio quiz shows like Queen for a Day, and Queen for a Day on radio begat This Is Your Life on television, and This Is Your Life begat a family named Loud that begat reality television, that begat big-time professional wrestling, and big-time professional wrestling begat The Apprentice that begat President Donald J. Trump? Or not? Don't ask me, I'm tempted to say. I just write poems. I am an expert at nothing except the sounds of sentences in the English language. My translation, The Inferno of Dante, is not an accomplishment of scholarship. It tries to be a feat of metrical engineering, composed with the instrument of my voice, intended for any reader's voice. Poetry, that peculiar form of musical composition in speakable words, an ancient bodily and imaginative art, does not confer the power to know which American creations are great and which are just plausible or worse. If the Dante translation works as art, then like my poems and all of my writing, it is part of an American process of adaptation and adoption. Some might call it appropriation. For me, that uncertain sense of still making up the culture as we go along adds to the thrill of poetry as an American art. I used to hear people talk enviously about poetry in the Soviet Union. They marveled at those soccer stadiums where poets declaimed their poems in the flamboyant Russian style to audiences of tens of thousands. I never was impressed. In a culture where poetry had long established snob value, and the words You have no culture are an insult.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.